Golden days in the sunshine of our happy youth. Golden days full of gaiety and full of youth.
His youth does seem to have been happy enough, and for at least part of his professional life there was no real shortage of gaiety. But truth, well, that's something not easy to arrive at in Mario Lanza's case, even when you talk to people with some claim to know what the truth is.
He never sang softly when he was rehearsing at all, which is unusual. He had to sing full out in order to sort of sing at all.
In our hearts, we remember them all else above. Golden days, days of youth and love.
As for Beltin, I was agreeably surprised by the sheer delicacy of his singing.
Oh, we laugh with a joy that only love can bring. Looking back through memories.
We were shattered, actually, to find that every word was mouthed by his conductor, and suddenly it became terribly apparent that Mario Lanza couldn't sing a note or a phrase without his conductor sort of guiding him through the sequence.
We will know life has nothing sweeter than its springtime.
The way Mario phrased reminds me of the great classical singer Elizabeth Schwarzkopf, who once told me that before she even starts to learn the notes of a song by Hugo Wolf or Schumann or Brahms, she learns the poem and she gets the maximum meaning out of the words, and then she turns to the music. And I see a parallel there. Mario put everything into the phrasing.
Golden days when we're young.
Contradictions you unearth when you try to find out about Mario Lanza are not simply major differences of opinion, and let me add right away, of informed opinion, of the kind you heard there. On successive pages, for example, of the same MGM press handout, there are two places of birth. For a long time, you could take your pick of three dates of birth, with 3 years between them. There are several versions of the story of his discovery, most of them slightly too good to be true. He was any height between 5'7", which meant he had to wear elevator shoes, which hurt him, and 6 feet in his socks. His weight, well, that varied genuinely according to whether he was making a film or not, and fictitiously according to the degree of malice felt by the writer of the article. Now, some of that may sound like quibbles over nothing more than fan club fodder, but Mario Lanza's weight was perhaps the most vital statistic of all. He did fluctuate between sheer grossness at 20 stone and an athletic bulkiness at 13 or 14. And it was this fluctuation, in particular the attempts to get from the first to the second in a hurry, which helped to kill him. So that apparently irrelevant personal detail is going to figure a great deal in what follows. But amid the confusions and contradictions, one opinion remains constant enough to count almost as a fact: that Mario Lanza had one of the great natural tenor voices of this century. Here's one authority quoting another. This is Henry Pleasance, London music correspondent of the New York Herald Tribune, and a music historian who's written books about singers.
Mario simply had this wonderful natural sound. My friend George London, who toured with Mario for, I think, about a year and a half with what was called in those days the Metropolitan Opera Trio, and who, in the course of his career, sang with all of the greatest singers of his generation, always said that he thought, in terms of natural vocal endowment, Mario had more voice than just about any man that he'd ever known.
La costor avvenenza e qual volo di quel fato torna gradita, forse un'altra, forse un'altra, de bello sarà un altra, forse un'altra, de bello sarà.
Mario Lanza sang Questa o Quella, among many other operatic excerpts, in The Great Caruso. It was his third film. It took more at the box office than any other film in 1951. And although the word hadn't been coined, it made him a superstar. He didn't need the word. He had all the attributes. The talent, the charisma, another word that show business was still looking for, the extravagance, the temperament. But astonishingly, for a performer who was turning what were then called bobby soxers onto at least small doses of opera, he'd had comparatively little of the orthodox operatic training. Some voice training, yes, but he'd played, at the most, only three operatic roles on stage. Yet here he was, portraying, as an early magazine article had it, the celluloid Caruso, at the age of what we must assume to be 30. I put it like that because a little paperback biography, more of a fan publication, really, sets the date of his birth at 1924, while an apparently well-informed piece in Collier's Weekly, written at the time of his first film, says 1922. Studio handouts omit the year altogether for a while, and then it appears as 1921. Now, since that was the year of Caruso's death, since Lanza later believed, or appeared to believe, that he was Caruso's successor, almost by divine right, well, you're entitled to wonder. Then again, nearly all the early references to him have him born in New York City, but then it becomes South Philadelphia. A small point, but all part of that pattern of tinkering which seems to go with the film industry. Having said all that, though, what mattered was the voice.
And when I told them how beautiful you are, they didn't believe me. They didn't believe me. Your lips, your eyes, your cheeks, your hair are in a class beyond compare. You're the loveliest girl that one could see. And I'm certainly going to tell them that I'm the man whose girl one day you'll be. They'll never believe me. They'll never believe me. From this great big world you've chosen me.
One of the things which has always interested me, particularly about Mario, is that I think he's the last of the singers who sang in a classical style with a classical vocal production, who became a very successful singer of popular songs. It's a curious thing that if you look back even 30 or 40 years, all of the great opera singers of that time sang popular songs and were popular singers. Tauber, McCormick, Giancipura, Caruso, you name it, they all sang popular songs. The last ones of my memory, of course, were people like Lawrence Tibbett and John Charles Thomas. Nowadays, I can't think of a single singer singing in that operatic style who is a top singer of popular songs. The idioms grew too far apart, and in this sense, Mario rather overlapped that transition. He was singing popular songs in a classical style long beyond the time when anybody else was.
Henry Pleasance putting his finger on something which is obvious enough once it's been pointed out. That old Jerome Kern Herbert Reynolds song was one of the non-operatic pieces Mario Lanza sang in his first film, That Midnight Kiss, 1949. The events leading up to that picture might themselves have been worked out at some Hollywood script conference. The boy, Alfred Arnold Cocozza, had grown up in South Philadelphia as a slightly spoiled only child with a powerful physique, a strong leaning towards athletic activities, particularly weightlifting and boxing, and a marked disinclination to do much orthodox work. In one interview, he saw himself, in retrospect, as a waterfront loafer. His father had been disabled during the First World War and spent much of his time playing over a collection of well-worn Caruso records. At some stage, the boy started to sing with these old discs, impressively enough for the parents, badly off as they were, to get him to a singing teacher. In interviews, Mario claimed to have been 14, while his mother maintained he was 16. Just one more discrepancy. Anyway, when he was about 20, somebody engineered some kind of audition with the classical conductor Koussevitzky. The favorite story is that he was helping move a piano into the Philadelphia Academy of Music and burst into song at the right moment to be overheard. Lanza himself denied this, but in the end, the story outlived him. Koussevitzky certainly did hear, was impressed, and did arrange for the young man to appear at the Music Festival in Massachusetts. He also persuaded him to change his name, so it was as Mario Lanza, a masculine version of his mother's name, that he was signed to a contract by a concert manager. But it was as Private Cocozza that he was almost simultaneously whisked into the American Armed Forces. He got into the entertainment side of things eventually, gained some fame as the Forces Caruso, and finished the war in the cast of the Air Force show Winged Victory. Then, as a civilian, he did some highly satisfying concert tours, which took him 2 years running to the Hollywood Bowl. And that, of course, brought him into contact with his first leading lady, Kathryn Grayson. Miss Grayson explains the part played in Lanza's film discovery by Mrs. Coverman, a member of Louis B. Mayer's studio staff at MGM.
Mr. Mayer's executive secretary, Ida Coverman, she was marvelous with all the young people, and she was a great music lover. And she actually discovered many, many people for the studio and for Mr. Mayer. He could rely on her judgment, you know. And she was quite a patron of the arts. She saw him the year before in a quartet. Then the year after was the year that she took Mr. Mayer and me to hear him. And then the next day he came out to the studio and we sang together, and the voices blended beautifully, so that was the starting point.
Mio pensiero, tu sei regina, tu di mia vita sei lo splendor.
Oh, cielo, vorrei ridarti le dolci purezze del patrio suolo.
The film That Midnight Kiss was previewed in California, reported Collier's Weekly in September 1949, and I quote, a husky young operatic tenor sang an aria called Celeste Aida, and a representative group of bobby soxers stood up in the aisles and cheered. Well, obviously most of the credit for that must go to all the things that Mario Lanza had in his favour in his late 20s. The looks, the voice, that extra secret ingredient. But some of it belongs to the producer who had sufficient insight and a great enough commercial flair to translate Louis B. Mayer's general enthusiasm into several reels of box office fact. 13 or 14 years earlier, he'd backed his own hunch and made a star out of a little girl called Diana Durbin. Well, in Hollywood, Joseph Pasternak looked back for us to his first encounter with Mario Lanza.
Louis B. Mayer one day called all the producers and asked them to come into the soundstage. And everybody was seated, and he said, I have a surprise for you. And it turned out a button, and a voice came out. It was the most beautiful voice I've ever heard in my life. And he said, this is our new discovery. A few minutes later, the curtain parted, and out walked Mario Lanza, bushy head. It looked like almost a caveman. And all the producers left. I was the only one who stayed there. And I said to Mr. Mayer, I'm going to do something with him because I like his voice. And that's how it started.
A caveman. So first there was the cosmetic side of things to be seen to.
Mario Lanza was a big problem. From the minute on, he was very stubborn, and he had kinky hair. And I had come to a lady's hairdresser to straighten his hair out. He didn't like it first, but after he saw it, he loved it. And I made the first four pictures with him.
Well, you can take your new star to the hairdressers, but that doesn't make a big, husky man slim enough for the cameras. And for the 10 years that were left to him, weight was going to be Mario Lanza's biggest visible problem. Ironically, it was precisely that which brought together Mario and the man who would be his staunchest friend for the rest of his life, and who would take over the legal guardianship of the Lanza children after both Mario and his wife were gone. His name is Terry Robinson.
Mario Lanza and I met through Louis B. Mayer, the head of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer Studios, in late 1947. I had the gymnasium there. I was known as the trainer of the stars. And Mr. Mayer said to me, I've signed a boy to a contract. I want you to work with him. He has to lose 25 pounds in a month. And he's going to come to see you. His name is Mario Lanza. I never heard of Mario Lanza because Mario Lanza was a concert singer, hadn't even made a record yet at this particular time. And I met this handsome, dark-haired fellow, and he said, Terry, I know you. I've seen you box in Philadelphia. I'm from Philadelphia. I said, yeah, I boxed there once, but that's quite some time ago. You got to have a good memory. We knew each other about 5 days when he said to me, Terry, I have to move. Can you help me? As you know, Betty is pregnant. Betty was his wife. And he said, I need a friend to help me. I said, fine. Saturday, I said, the studio's closed. I'll help you move. Now, I never heard the boy sing. The only thing he ever did when we worked together was he would clear his throat. And I always thought he had some sort of a nasal drip. But I never butted in. While we were moving into a duplex apartment here in Beverly Hills, Betty said, why don't you play some music and I'll make some sandwiches and we'll have some Cokes. So fine, we sat down. Mario said, Terry, do you like opera? Do you know much about opera? I said, well, to be honest, I don't know that much about it. I'm from New York. I've actually never been to the Met. Mario put on this record and I heard this voice singing Vesti la Giuba. I said, now I know what people mean about Caruso. Now I understand. Is this a collector's item of Caruso? Because I've never heard Caruso sound this good, even on my grandmother's old Victrola. And as I said that, his wife came in with a tray of sandwiches, and she was laughing. Well, I realized I said something wrong, and I said, well, who is that if that's not Caruso? She said, that's your friend over there, stupid. Had this kind of a voice, and then I understood what Mr. Mayer meant when he said to me, don't leave this kid's side, I want you to stay with him at all times, he's going to be my biggest star. The next day at the studio, when I told Mr. Mayer what I thought, Mr. Mayer said to me, he said, Terry, this will be the biggest star Metro ever had. And it turned out that way for the few years that Mario made his films at MGM, until of course the tragedies occurred.
The real tragedies were still somewhere in the future. But given that a man has the seeds of his own destruction in him, there can't be another place on earth like old-time Hollywood for making them germinate.
Success is much harder to take than a failure. Success, he was not equipped to be very successful, and he became overnight the sensation of the world. And I don't think he could take it. The most exciting thing that he ever had, he came to me one day and he showed me a check for $1,100,000 for royalties on his recordings. And, you know, if a man didn't have $10 and you get a check like that, very few of them could stay sober. It was always difficult, you know, because the temperament, a great artist has a temperament, especially singers. But after the fourth picture, after he finished the fourth picture, it was almost impossible to get along with.
Mario Lanza's success was not simply confined to films. As you heard Joe Pasternak say, he had this enormous royalty check, $1,100,000. That was for his records. In particular for a million-plus seller, which in 1950 simply took off in a way that left the industry panting. The record business hadn't developed into the gold rush we're used to. The song came from a film, though, Lanza's second, The Toast of New Orleans.
Hand in hand, we'll find love's promised land. There'll be no in hand, we'll find love's promised land. There'll be no one but you for me. Peter and Lanza, if you will be my love.
Mario Lanza was now big in every sense of the word. Temperamentally, it seemed to Joe Pasternak that his protege was trying to teach him the business.
All of a sudden, you know, how to direct the picture better, how to select the music better, how to prepare a story. He just learned the business. It took me a lifetime, and he learned it after three pictures. I gave in most of the time. I wanted to preserve him, because a voice like that doesn't come in, it comes only once in a lifetime, and I was afraid of him, he was going to lose it.
So you're not surprised to find stories in the more gossipy press of Lanza threatening to punch Pasternak. At the same time, remember, Joe Pasternak was, and probably still is, a man with very strong views on what's right for a star to be doing, which must be rather galling if you happen to be the star. But where a columnist will see violence and bad temper, Terry Robinson will recall only high spirits.
Mario was a practical joker. He actually liked Joe in his heart. He really did. Joe made three great films with Mario, made his first film. But Mario was a little bit of a devil. And when Mario got a little angry, he was devilish. And he had a brand new Cadillac, but Mr. Pasternak had moved into a beautiful home in Bel Air, California, and he made a replica of his home for his mailbox out of wood, and even had it painted to resemble this big home. And this is where they would put the mail in, and Pasternak or whoever worked for him would go out and get the mail. And we were driving around, and Marciano was in the car, the great heavyweight champ, and Vince and myself, and Mario was driving. And I felt like taking the wheel, and I said, why don't you rest, let me drive. He said, no, he said, let's go around once more. I want them to see how big and all the property Pasternak has. And then, as we drove, the lights of our car hit this beautiful new replica of the house, this mailbox. And Mario took the car and smashed into that mailbox, and it went into 5,000 pieces. It took the three of us to lift the car off the mailbox, or what was left of it. And he apologized to Joe the next day, but we all called Joe. And Joe, what was Joe going to say? So Mario went ahead and got a carpenter at the studio and paid him a few hundred dollars to make another one for Mr. Pasternak. But that was Mario, see? I don't know, when I look back, I laugh at some of these things. I was mad when he did it. It was destructive. But he laughed. He laughed for 3 days, and it took him out of a depression.
Mezzo mare, mamma mia, si salterà. L'are bella per danzare, chi in amor non mancherà. Già la luna mezzo mare, mamma mia, si salterà. L'are bella per danzare, chi in amor non mancherà. Già la luna mezzo mare, mamma mia, si salterà. Presto in danza, tonda, tonda, donne mie, venite qua. Un garzon bello giocondo a ciascuno toccherà. Finché in ciel brilla una stella e la luna splenderà, il più bel con la più bella tutta notte danzerà. Mamma mia, già la luna in mezzo a mare. Mamma mia, si salterà. Frinche, 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 mamma mia, si salterà. Frinche, 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 mamma mia, si salterà. La 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 la.
Between films and when he wasn't trampling Joe Pasternak's mailbox to matchwood, Mario Lanza would overeat. Whether he often got through a steak with 6 eggs on top for breakfast, and whether it was 30 pieces of chicken or only 20 that he once ate at a sitting, and whether they were washed down by a gallon of milk or a dozen or so glasses of beer, is not so important as the fact that, first of all, he had a huge appetite, and that, secondly, some of his troubles, that useful phrase, hang-ups, was another still to be invented, that some of his troubles drove him to take refuge in food.
I remember once when we were having dinner, I had a 14-pound standing rib roast, and my cook brought in the roast, and Mario said, I'll slice it. And he sliced a slice for Betty, slice for Remy, a slice for Johnny, and ate the rest of it himself. He said, this is just the way I like it. And he ate the whole thing.
In actual fact, all Mario's appetites were large.
He loved the ladies. And that didn't help him either.
But it wasn't just Mario. That happens a great deal in motion pictures, people working that closely together. But it did happen with Mario, too. He often climbed over the gates. This, with Betty and I've laughed about it many times. Once my dog bit him in the seat. He did that cured him for a while. But he did things like that. Yeah, he was a character. He knew I knew that it was all bluff, you know. I took it as a joke, and it was a joke. So, because he knew that Betty was a very dear friend of mine, and Betty and I laughed over it. We talked about it and laughed about it, and that was the sort of relationship we had. There was nothing that we couldn't laugh about.
What it boiled down to, Miss Grayson decided, was that when he was good, he was very, very good. When he was bad, he was horrid. She quoted examples.
Well, if anybody was in trouble, he was the first to help. And then once in a while, he would start off the day roaring drunk. And that didn't go over very well. As a matter of fact, it went over like a lead balloon with the studio, let's put it that way. The people, you know, instead of knowing that he had to get up and go to work, didn't really care. These were the hangers-on. They were out, and no drink, have another drink, Tiger, and, you know, and he did. And he wouldn't be in very good shape the next day. David Niven and I would black coffee and crackers and things to sober him up, and he came through, though. He came through beautifully.
Why, beer. Lift your stein and drink your beer.
Eins, zwei, drei, vier. Lift your stein and drink your beer. Drink, drink, drink. Two eyes that are bright as stars when they're shining on me.
Drink, 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 drink. The lips that are red and sweet as the fruit on the tree. Here's a hope that those bright eyes will shine.
Came from the one film in which Mario Lanza was heard but not seen, The Student Prince. The details of that we shall come to when, among other speakers, Edmund Purdom, who was the one actually seen in the film, will put forward a theory about Lanza's non-appearance, which forms a tantalizing third alternative to the reasons given by the studios on one hand and by Mario's friend Terry Robinson on the other. That film would involve the most titanic rows between star and studio that Hollywood could remember since the 20s. But the germ of the troubles was there early on, both in Mario's temperament and in the Hollywood setup. Here's Terry Robinson talking about those stories of Mario's temperament, which were current almost from the start.
When we hear of the temperamental Mr. Lanza, I'll tell you how that happened. When Mario first came to this town and he started to sing at the studio to pre-record his first film, word got around the studio about this magnificent voice. He was invited to Hollywood parties, and I went along with him. He did not know much about this town, so I went along with Mario and Betty, of course. Now, Betty was pregnant, so sometimes she wouldn't go. She was sick. We went maybe two or three times a week to various directors, producers' homes, and every time the evening would roll on, they would ask Mario to sing. One day, Mario said to me, "We got a party to go to tomorrow night. Do you think they're inviting me as a human being, or are they inviting just my voice? What do you think?" I said, "Are you kidding? They all love you, kid. You're a big thing already, and your picture hasn't been shown." He said, "I'll tell you what we'll do. Tomorrow night at the party, I won't sing. You tell them I have a sore throat. Let's see what happens." Well, we went to this big famous producer's party. There was about 300 people there, you know, where they all go out on a lawn and sit around a pool. And sure enough, I noticed a piano and a piano player coming out and start to play. And I walked over to the host and I said, so-and-so, without mentioning names, "You know, Mario don't feel well. I hope you don't ask him to sing. He's got a red throat." The guy said, "You got to be kidding me. What the hell do you think I got you guys here for?" And I realized myself that they weren't inviting Mario as he wanted to be invited, a man. They were inviting an entertainer, a guy with a voice. And he didn't sing that night. And 2 days later, around the studio, word went around that, "What do you think of this guy, Lanza? He's seeing the rushes on his film. He thinks he's a big shot. He won't sing anymore. He won't partake in these parties," and this and that. From that day on, Mario Lanza never sang in anybody else's house, unless he wanted to. Or he had people come to his house. And word went around the studio he's temperamental.
Well, Mario's relationship with his wife, Betty, was a fairly tempestuous one. She was part Irish, he was mostly Italian. It was a mixture which could produce both explosion and harmony, and it was probably the only long-term arrangement that Mario's need for extremes would have tolerated. But he had to work with people. Interviewer Michael Gray talked to Joe Pasternak on that.
Kathryn Grayson he loved, but the most respected star he ever worked with is Ed Blight, when we did The Great Caruso. She just told him plain off, she said, "Listen, if you ever speak to me in the foul language, I'll walk off the set." And he respected her. She was not scared of him. Most of them were a little bit afraid of him. And as I know, in my association with him, I find out that the only girl he ever respected was Ann Blight.
What was his relationship with Kathryn Grayson? Did they become great friends?
They were enemies. They were friends. You know, all of it was raining or it was sunshine. You couldn't figure him out. She was a big star when he was nobody, and she was very nice to him. In the second picture, he was already a star. And he just forgot that she helped him along in the first picture. But I think he had a great deal of love for Kathryn Grayson.
Did they ever try to upstage each other?
No, I don't think so. He didn't know. He was not educated enough to know what upstaging is.
I wonder if that's strictly true. After all, he was Caruso's successor.
Because you come to me with naught save love, and hold my hand and lift mine eyes above, a wider world of hope and joy I see. Because you come to me. Because you speak to me in accents sweet, I find the roses waking round my feet, and I am led through tears and joy to thee. Because you speak to me.
make our love divine.
After The Great Caruso came Because You're Mine. There were frequent reports of Lanza's dislike of the picture. He was to play a young opera singer called up into the army. How can Caruso be a private, he's alleged to have said angrily to Pasternak. Whether Mario took up his knife and fork as a protest against situations he didn't like leads us into psychiatrist territory, and at best we could only speculate. But Mario certainly did have his already familiar problem again. This time, fleetingly, there was an attempt to put it in a kindlier light. A paragraph in The Star in October 1951 says, Mario Lanza will not be singing the 14 songs lined up for him in Because You're Mine for a few weeks, maybe more, because he has to undergo thyroid tests. By dieting and exercise, he's managed to get down a little in weight, but it's thought that the difficulty he has in losing weight is due to a thyroid condition. It was a gallant try. Eventually, the film was made, and Lanza lost no time in telling everybody it was terrible. He was, in fact, heading for his final huge bust-up with MGM. But it did well at the box office, and at the very moment when the studio and the star were getting ready for their big battle over the student prince, Because Your Mine was selected for the Royal Film Performance in Britain of 1952. It struck the Times as an odd choice. It has usually been possible dimly to guess, said the Times, at the considerations which may have influenced any particular decision, but this year one is left gasping and speechless. Well, the Times critic might not be able to speak, but he had plenty to write. He went on, Mr. Lanza can certainly sing, and sing he does, with or without excuse, rhyme or reason. The film might have turned itself into a gramophone recital of his records, without appreciable loss to anyone. Private royal reactions to royal performance films are not recorded, but the public voted for Because You're Mine with its wallet, as usual. Quite apart from anything which might be happening to him physically, Mario Lanza was big, as they say, at the box office. And in the eyes of his fans, he would never fall from grace. From the start almost to the finish, he knew both the joys and the irritations of stardom.
No matter where we went, women would throw themselves at him. He couldn't walk the streets. When we sat in a car, if he was recognized and there were girls driving a car, they would try to chase us up on a sidewalk. They would try to block our car. Mario, we love you, we love you. They'd sing Be My Love to him. They'd scream. Whenever we went on tour, we had police escorts. we would get a lot of letters with nude photos. This is what I look like. And they would send their panties to him. Please autograph my panties. The things that came in the mail were terrible. His wife would open a mail, and we'd keep it away from the kids. They were growing. But we had people come to the door, ask for money. And we had people call up and say, send me money. I'm pregnant. You got me pregnant. There's a guy running around Italy right now who says he's Mario Lanza's son. He's as old as Lanza, yet he says he's Mario Lanza's son. He's singing in the other parts of the world. The guy's a complete fake. Mario's four children are right here.
Well, he might have been a complete fake, but he did for a while get a recording contract in Germany on the strength of it. Well, after Because You're Mine had been shown in 1952, Mario Lanza had 7 years left to him. Almost a recluse, he would reach nearly the bottom of his vast, if quickly acquired, fortune. He would find that his reputation for hell-raising would outweigh his reputation for money-making, and experience difficulty in getting work. He would make a film in unprecedented harmony with Warner Brothers, but he would eventually leave Hollywood in disgust and come to Europe. It wasn't all his fault, and one day somebody will discover just why his period with MGM was so stormy. MGM, after all, had a reputation for bossiness. But Mario was his own worst enemy, and he managed to get a lot of people on his side. Presumably in fits of rage and frustration, he practically wrecked the home in Hollywood that he'd rented for 2 years. The owner sued him, and there was a rather sordid court case, of which it was said only the ceilings were intact. Well, if that's true, then Mario had been driven beyond the limits of mere temperament. Even MGM could see that.
We had him go to a psychiatrist. And after two or three sessions, this psychiatrist called the studio head and they said, listen, he wants to cure me.
Well, that's one thing you can say for stories about Mario Lanza. They're never weak. And can you imagine being sent to a psychiatrist by the very organization on which you blame your troubles? In any case, Lanza's attitude to the psychiatrist could hardly have surprised Mr. Pasternak, since Hollywood, even at that period of its existence, was still a kind of reservation for supreme egotists. Not only that, that particular kind of violent petulance was not restricted to Mario Lanza, as I discovered when I talked to Henry Pleasance.
He was apparently very destructive, but I remember another singer who, in his early days, had quite a reputation for that, was Uzi Buerling. Yeah, who was a fantastically strong fellow, and apparently when he had one on, he could break up some furniture too.
Well, if big tenors can shatter glasses with their voices, I suppose it's hardly surprising that some of them should carry the destruction the stage further. And it does serve to emphasize one point. For the operatic stage tenor, physical bulk is not much of a drawback. Opera audiences can suspend belief and see in the leading singer the romantic hero the story demands. But the cinema, with the almost indecent intimacy of the close-up at its disposal, makes artificial demands in insisting on both voice and looks.
Touch them from here. Words falling to rhyme any time you are holding me near. When you are in love, it's the loveliest night. Wonderful touch of your hand.
stand. My heart starts to beat like a child when a birthday is near. So kiss me, my sweet. It's the loveliest night of the year.
Mario Lanza's other million-plus seller. There weren't to be too many highlights of that size during the latter part of Mario's life. Soon would come the suspension and ultimate dismissal by MGM over the making of The Student Prince. But as Rady Harris, columnist for The Hollywood Reporter, points out, Lanza was not alone in being disciplined by the front office.
If the star got out of line, they would hear from the office upstairs. I mean, L.B. Mayer and Jack Warner and Daryl Zanuck wouldn't put up with any of that nonsense. And they were held very much in line. But then they made so many more pictures a year then, so they had to, you know. But Bogey and Cagney and Betty Davis, Olivia de Havilland were all put on suspension for if they objected to a script or if they weren't allowed to come late. They had to be there right, you know, at the start of production and work through until the end of the day. And they were like children at school. They had to obey the rules.
No wonder then that when an almost immovable object, like a Hollywood studio, is in collision with a nearly irresistible force like Mario Lanza, the result is damage. We'll look at some of that damage and the disasters and triumphs which came out of it when we cover the events which led to Mario's final Hollywood films, his decision to come to Europe, and the end in Italy, in Mario Lanza, The Road to Rome, a sad sequel to The Golden Days.
Golden days in the sunshine of our happy youth. Golden days full of gaiety and full of truth. In our hearts, we remember them all else above. Golden days, days of youth and love. How we laugh with a joy that only love can bring. Looking back through memories, we will know life has nothing sweeter than its springtime. Golden days when we're young.
We left Mario Lanza on the point of not appearing in the film version of The Student Prince. The significance of that we'll come to in a moment. This song, meanwhile, comes from the next film he did make, Serenade.
My destiny, your smile is my destiny, and I must be what you want me to be. Beyond the stars in your eyes, when you are near, life is sheer ecstasy. Take my arms, for you alone can make my earth a heavenly cathedral.
is my destiny, and I'm content nevermore to be free. Your lips control my very heart and my soul, and I am chained to my destiny.
The words of the songs Mario Lanza sang in English often had an uncanny bearing on the singer's own life. When he came to the line, "I must be what you want me to be," early on in that lyric, I wonder if it occurred to him that it summed up all his old troubles with the people at MGM. If those battles between him and the studio had been about any one thing, surely it was their demands that he get his weight down to fit the parts they insisted he should perform. My Destiny was one of the songs in Serenade, which he made in 1955, in apparently happy circumstances for Warner Brothers, so perhaps he could look back with some amusement. What he'd be looking back on were three ordinarily successful films, another, The Great Caruso, which made so much money at the box office that it qualified for those strange words of approval, boffo and socco, in the American trade paper Variety, and one other film which was a success and which owed its existence to him, but in which he didn't appear. Now, all that had been compressed into something under 5 hectic years. The film in which only his singing voice had been heard was The Student Prince. Though I suppose only is hardly the word.
Tonight was just a masquerade. Tomorrow just another day. Let come whatever, tonight or never, I'll throw the mask away. Beloved, with all my heart I love you. With every breath I pray, someday you will be mine. Summer or spring, winter or fall. Jealous of the way your eyes sparkle and shine, day after day, near or apart. I try to say, be still to my trembling heart, but try though I may, I cannot hide passion inside that won't be denied. If this be madness, then call it madness. I only know I'll never rest till you are mine. When I tell you, from now until the last bright star fades from the blue, now and forever, whatever I do, beloved,
for us to concentrate for part of this program on a picture in which he wasn't actually seen, must at first look like a touch of Mario Lanza's own reported perverseness. But his non-appearance in The Student Prince was perhaps the central and most disrupting fact in his entire screen career. The non-appearance, anyway, was a fact. The reasons for it, though, take us straight back into that area of confusion and contradiction in which most of his life story seems to have been written. This is film producer Joe Pasternak giving what must be considered the official version.
They love to eat. And I talked to him a couple of times, and he says, all right, I'll stop it tomorrow. In the fifth picture of The Student Prince, he's supposed to play the part. And he was measuring for the uniforms, and they're all ready. They fit him, and when he came again to starting the picture, he couldn't get into the uniforms. And it became to be impossible. So the studio made a deal with him. He used his voice. And an actor by the name of Edmund Purdom played the part. That was my fifth picture. It was supposed to be with Mario, but he never played it. Only his voice was there. I think there was a great shock to him. He didn't believe that was going to happen. I was very upset and heartbroken about that he didn't do the picture. He loved the story. He loved the character. Edmund Purdom did a beautiful job that time more.
Joseph Pasternak, repeating the usual reasons for Mario Lanza's not being seen in The Student Prince. He didn't fit the costumes and so on. And adding the thought that Lanza was surprised and hurt when they did go ahead and use just his voice. But Terry Robinson, Lanza's closest friend and constant companion at that time, puts the reasons for the disappointment a little further back and blames the studio.
When we finished the film The Great Caruso and we went to see the rushes of that film, and we noticed that we had an opera picture that would be a bonanza, because Lanza at this time had a record out called Be My Love, which was sweeping the world. Mario said to the studio, I'm going on a tour. When I come back, I'd like to do The Student Prince. Two producers and one of the top vice presidents of the studio at MGM told Mario, that's your next picture when you come back, The Student Prince. They said to me, Terry, keep him well. When he comes back, we want him right to go into this film. We went away for 4 months, and the tour was called Lanza Bonanza. That was the tour. It was the most fantastic tour in the history of show business at that time, where an opera singer was mobbed by fans all over, sold out, standing rooms only. When we came back, Mario clapped his hands at a meeting we had with all the big shots of the studio, and he said, let's go, boys. Let's do The Student Prince. One of the executives of the studio stood up and said, we got a better idea. We have a comedy to make. You're going to be an opera singer who gets drafted in the army. Mario said, what are you talking about? You promised me The Student Prince. I want to give the public class. I want to give them culture. I want costumes in a movie. I don't want to play a comedy. I don't want to be a comedian again. I played a soldier in my first picture. I'm not going to do it. Give me The Student Prince. At this time, the studios were the bosses. Since the boy was under contract, he had to make the picture they asked him to make. He made that picture under protest. But following this film, MGM ordered Mario to do The Student Prince. But Mario was stubborn, and Mario did not do The Student Prince. He made the recordings, and he allowed the studio to use his voice, but he did not make the film.
So, while you're hearing the voice of Mario Lanza, American tenor, you're looking at the face and actions of Edmund Purdom, British and a baritone. You've heard two versions of the reason for Mario Lanza's visual part being taken over by another actor. Now here's a third, a theory admittedly, but the man who holds it came uncommonly close to Lanza, even if he never met him. Edmund Purdom, who was an almost unknown MGM contract player when he was asked to become the face and body of Lanza's voice.
You know, I've convinced myself that Lanza didn't run out because of overweight or slimming or dieting or anything like that. Lanza simply didn't believe that The Student Prince was a vehicle for Mario Lanza. You see, all the films that he'd done up till then were really basically the same story. The story of the poor boy with the great voice who finally strikes it big and ends up at the Met. Certainly, The Great Caruso was a classical example. And Mario Lanza played Mario Lanza, although he was, as it were, impersonating this great singer. He just felt that it was not a vehicle for him. And it's surprising, perhaps, because Joe Pasternak had taken this ancient classic and turned it into a very sophisticated screenplay. In the first place, Bill Ludwig and Sonia Levine did the screenplay, and they were very famous writers. And they made of this character a rather stiff Prussian who needed to be humanized, who needed to be charmed. And the whole essence of the MGM screenplay, which perhaps Lanza failed to appreciate, was that he had to fall in love and to be humanized by Kathy. And he just didn't see it that way. He wanted to play what he'd played up till then. And he probably felt that it was asking too much for him to impersonate a Prussian, to start acting something which wasn't him, which wasn't his personality.
So there was young Mr. Purdom, going through agonies trying to match up his own speaking voice with the borrowed Italianate American singing voice of Mario Lanza. He remembers the spoken parts as being perhaps the hardest to do, because the singing had a kind of built-in advantage.
His voice was a simply fabulous voice to act to, because after all, I wasn't just standing there imitating a singer singing, or even impersonating him, God forbid. I was playing the prince in the story, a very beautifully written story, and bursting into song at the appropriate moment. It was an absolutely tremendous experience. You know, I used to have the playback on the set going absolutely flat out, because I was singing flat out as well, but I'm a baritone, as you can probably hear. I'm a baritone, and he was a tenor, and I could never hit the top notes, and I used to wince and stop the take, and they'd say, "What's the matter?" And I'd say, "Well, I didn't get the top notes." And they'd say, "But we're not using your voice." "Well, I'm sure I grimaced or did something awful visually, so I'm sorry I stopped the take. Could we do another one?" And I used to have the thing going flat out, but it was a most tremendous experience. It was enough to make you sweat just listening to the voice, particularly at a very high level.
I hear your voice in the wind that stirs the willows. I see your face in the stars that shine above.
Hold me closer tonight, we love.
The willows bending, the stars that shine, the shore lights blending. They're yours and mine. Drifting along in my heart, there's a song, and the song in my heart will not fade. Oh, hear my serenade, my blossoms on the bough. Nothing is heard but the song of a bird, filling all the air with dreaming. Could this beauty last forever? Nothing more, believe me, let this night not live forever. For
Mario Lanza, the use of another actor, virtually miming to his singing, must have been humiliating. Before it came to that, he's reported to have said, I have recorded songs for them. They can have them. They can't dub them onto someone else's body. They wouldn't fit. But of course they did. And before the studio finally resorted to that curious practice, there was about a year during which reporters of the Hollywood scene could hardly believe their luck. Lanza was sued for ridiculous sums of money. He was suspended. Then their differences would be resolved and he would be starting on the actual shooting next month. Next month would come, but no Lanza, no filming. "I am an artist," Mario was reported as saying, "I don't want to be bothered with tiny details." However, MGM didn't think that turning up at the right time to start on a picture was such a tiny detail, though in the end they compromised. Lanza's recorded voice, and he'd already done the songs, was better than no Lanza, and certainly easier to handle. For a couple of years, rightly or wrongly, Mario's reputation for giving the studios a hard time made it very difficult for him to find people who would employ him. As early as mid-1953, newspaper articles are starting to describe him as a sullen, suspicious recluse. For 18 months or so, cuttings reporting his misbehavior practically amount to a paper chase. There was his failure to go on for an enormously highly paid Las Vegas club season, and another scandal when he appeared on television but only mimed to some of his old records. Then came a film for Warner Brothers, Serenade. When one London paper reviewed it, it complained that his arias might have been dug out of the third programme. What that meant, of course, was that there was a high proportion of solid opera in it, like this duet from Otello with Licia Albanese, an operatic soprano who was apparently delighted to be working with him.
Consiglio che il vago amor riallumina nel piccioletto artiglio. Mollemente alla prece s'appeggio che il figlio
Albanese, with whom Mario Lanza sang the Act 3 duet from Verdi's Otello in Serenade, and you heard her just then, is on record, or more precisely on record sleeve, both in praise of Mario's operatic voice and to the effect that he was on his best behavior during the shooting of Serenade. She wrote on the back of the album, "We don't know what has happened," the movie people said. "Since Albanese is here, Mario is behaving himself." Not that Albanese was his leading lady. The story provided him with two of those, one of whom was Joan Fontaine. With her, he was, well, high-spirited.
At the beginning of the film, Joan Fontaine had the superior attitude that Mario felt. There was a lack of communication. Now, he was the star of the film, and when we drive to the studio, he'd say, "You know, I can't get through to her. I wonder who she thinks she is. I got to break this dame down, or we're going to have a terrible picture here. For some reason, I'm not getting through to her. What the hell did I ever do to her? And it was the first time I met her, and I admired her work." So he said, "You know what I want you to do for me? You tell Mom tomorrow to make me a real Italian hoagie sandwich. And I want all the onions and all the garlic she ever put in a sandwich for me. Tell Mom to load it, Terry. You tell Mom I want this. Well, I went to the house. I stayed with his parents. We lived together. The next day, I carried a bag of a sandwich. They call them submarine hoagie sandwiches. And I'll tell you, it smelled out the car. And I said to him, are you going to eat this? You got to be crazy. He said, Terry, this is going to be my lunch, a magnificent lunch. I ate these when I was a little boy. I was raised on them. Don't forget, my grandfather had an Italian store. We went to the studio, and that day he had to do a scene where he had to get up close and kiss Joan Fontaine. Well, right before he went out, he ate that garlic sandwich. And he put nothing in his mouth after it. When he went out there and he blew a little passion into Joan Fontaine, she threw her arms up. Let me tell you, she'll never get near garlic as long as she lives. And that was Mario. And he loosened her up. They became great friends after that.
Do you believe that? Well, luckily, the people in the front row could only see and hear Mario Lanza. So no whiff of either scandal or hoagie sandwich reached them. Or the critic of the New York Times, who reported that Mr. Lanza never was in better voice. Another member of the cast of Serenade was Vince Edwards, now better known for the Ben Casey TV series. And he was admitted into the very small circle of Mario's close friends. He recalled how Mario was at that time, which would have been in, what, 1955?
Well, I can best describe him as unpredictable and really like a big kid. He was just always looking for fun, and he was a kind of a clown. I mean, really in life, kind of a trapped clown, trapped by success, trapped by all the notoriety of his career, and he was the kind of guy who just liked to have a good time. I had a house up in the Hollywood Hills, and a friend of mine was an animal trainer. He had two lions. Now, this animal trainer got in some financial difficulty, and some creditors were going to impound his truck and his cats. So he said to me that if I would store his animals and truck in my back yard, and I had a huge garden and a garage there where I could keep the cats. So I did. Now, the animal trainer was a bit skint, and occasionally always had trouble feeding the animals. So one day I told Mario about it, and 2 days later he showed up with half a steer in his car, a full half cow cut up and quartered to feed to the animals. And he said, from the tiger to the lion.
And the tiger, he encouraged people to call him that, the tiger further indulged himself singing snippets from some of the less hackneyed operas, like this, from Giordano's Fedora.
Oh,
Compared with his other films, Serenade was only moderately successful. One paper rather tartly said, the story continues to explore rich veins of idiocy, which probably meant that finding a theme which would credibly incorporate an operatic tenor was getting progressively more difficult. So, one way and another, there was a fair inducement to leave Hollywood and try Europe. Terry Robinson remembers the pressures he himself was under, and also Mario Lanza's defensive attitude towards the Hollywood setup.
What depressed Mario was when he was surrounded by liars. He was super sensitive. I was close to Lanza, close as a brother, and people would come up to me that never saw me before or had known who I was, close to this magnetic man making all this money. They would promise me anything if I could give them a song they wrote to give to Lanza. I had screenwriters, I had producers call me. I had people offer me anything under the sun if I could get scripts to Lanza. Everybody was trying to buy this new bonanza, Lanza Bonanza, this new great star. And those that got through us and those that got him in a corner, and they would tell stories, and he would believe some of the stories. Some of these people are dead today, some of them are still alive. And this is what happens to a big star. This is why Elvis Presley has six people around him wherever he goes. They don't let anyone get next to him. Colonel Parker wouldn't dare allow it. Mario trusted no one. After 5 years in Hollywood, I was the only close friend that stayed at the house with Mario Lanza. Everybody else, he did not trust. And Mario Lanza became like a hermit. He only palled around with Vince Edwards. He palled around with Rocky Marciano, the great champion, who passed away untimely, as Mario did. And he had few friends. He was afraid to make friends. He didn't want to be hurt. Because when he made a friend, as you read on this wristwatch, he said, thank you, Terry, for honoring me as a friend. That's how he felt about people. And then when he found these people would double-cross him, hence the broken heart.
Well, towards the end of 1956, the deal was set, and Mario was making plans to go to Rome to star in a film there. Ironically, the distribution was to be by MGM, but that didn't seem to worry them. All they wanted was not to have to make it. So, although columnist Donald Zeck was writing at the very end of 1956, two-ton tenor eating his way off the screen, by early 1957, Lanza was in Europe, hoping to redeem himself, his film career, and do some concerts. This is how film historian Philip Jenkinson sees Mario's migration to Europe, what had caused it, and what it meant to him.
When his career was on the wane, and when he'd had perhaps the ultimate of his very worst fights with MGM, and said, well, I can manage without you, and when everything seemed to be down, and when the chips were absolutely down, and nothing seemed to be left for him, and he decided to go back to the land, if not of his birth, of his ancestors, and went back to Rome, he received this tumultuous welcome where there were over 2,000 people at the airport all cheering for him. And this sustained him, the notion that there were all these people cheering and longing for him to make good. This, to him, I think, was probably more important than Joe Pasternak, his wife, MGM, and all the rest put together.
All our money we get, we have to spend on good things to eat for all our friend. The price, they are so very high, but the friend you cannot buy.
You got to make that.
Tonight is a party.
Tonight.
There's gonna be a party tonight.
A celebration.
So come along, everybody,
tonight.
And bring with you your appetite. Tonight is a party.
Tonight.
There's gonna be a party tonight. We have chicken cacciatore.
We have not.
And veal scallopini.
We haven't got.
But everything we make, we serve you hot, just so long as we got a pot.
I mean to cook
you. Tonight is a party.
Tonight.
There's gonna be a party tonight.
Lots of vino.
So let's invite everybody.
Tonight.
And bring along your appetite. Sing and dance and have such fun, and stay up late until we see the sun. There'll be lots of vino, nice and cool, so good with Buster Basu.
With plenty cheese, man.
Tonight is a party.
Tonight.
There's gonna be a party tonight.
A celebration.
So let's invite everybody.
Tonight.
And bring around your
That came from the Seven Hills of Rome, made in Rome. Where other songs can be seen to have relevance to Mario Lanza's life, that one, with its menu and its wine list, would appear to be tempting providence. And there was indeed no sign that Lanza had left his appetites behind him in America. When in Rome, where the Hollywood Reporter columnist Rady Harris met him, he appears to have done what Rome and he himself had always done. Not that it bothered anyone.
People weren't particularly interested, I don't think, in his private life so much. You know, he was like all Italians. I mean, his family and his religion came first. And any extramarital affairs that he had or anything extracurricular, that was just taken as normal for Italians, you know. And I don't think he thought about it or discussed it much. He was basically a family man, that was for certain.
And it was in 1957 also that he came to Britain for the first time. These were the days when celebrities still arrived at railway stations, and the Rome airport scenes described just now by Philip Jenkinson were duplicated on the continental arrival platform at Victoria. A variously estimated number of ladies demonstrated their love of him by knocking him over. Several reporters exclusively helped him to his feet, and he managed, apparently in the same breath, to tell some of them that he loved it and to complain to others that somebody had torn out a lump of his hair. Never mind, he was in London. That was the main thing, and he'd come to sing.
Perché mi dice sti parole amore, perché mi voglio il cuore male, tu remiendo cadarì, e non te scurrerò, fatagge da vuotore cadarì, e non te Caderì, caderì che venne vincerà, spogliò che mi rasposerà, e tu non sei
been arranged that Lanza should come to London in November 1957 to do a Sunday night at the Palladium TV show. But after that was all set, he was booked for that year's Royal Variety performance, which he actually did first. The musical director for both shows that year was Cyril Ornadel, which means that he came as close to Lanza, professionally, as perhaps anyone else you're likely to meet in England. Though you have to remember, of course, that Mario Lanza brought his own conductor with him as well. I went to see Cyril Ornadel, and he described to me the preparations for the Royal Variety performance.
When the rehearsal started, his conductor, Konstantino Kalanikos, came and took over the orchestra, and I sat down by the side of him. And first of all, Constantino Kalanikos ran the orchestrations through, and Mario Lanza was just sitting in the stalls. And when he was ready, Mario Lanza came up onto the stage, and they started to run the numbers. And we were shattered, actually, to find that every word and every bar was mouthed by his conductor. And suddenly it became terribly apparent that Mario Lanza couldn't sing a note or a bar or a phrase without his conductor sort of guiding him through the sequence. But when you stopped looking at that, at the technicalities of it, you just listened to this gorgeous natural voice that was singing so beautifully.
You also saw him, and you can clear up this business of, was he a gross-looking man at that time?
Not at all. He was very slim, very good-looking, and in fact, he was exactly as his image was portrayed on the films.
Did you have a chance to gauge the audience reaction? Obviously, it's a special audience, but he seems throughout his life to have had this magical influence upon women.
Oh, yes. There were two occasions. The command performance was on the Monday in November. I think it was the 18th of November, 1957. And then he did a Sunday night at the London Palladium on the following Sunday to widely varied audiences. On the night of the Royal Command, which is generally known as a sort of a stuffy audience, absolutely, he got royal acclaim. I mean, absolutely roars, which is very unusual for there. And, of course, Judy Garland had preceded him on the following week at Sunday night at the London Palladium, when, again, you have a different sort of audience. They tore the place up.
Well, of course, audiences do tend to react not only to the performer, but also to the occasion. So I asked Cyril Lauderdale to pass a more detached, professional judgment on the quality of Lanza's voice purely as a sound.
Absolutely gorgeous. No doubt about it, the man had a most beautiful, natural voice. He was amongst the greats. For instance, Gracie Fields had this terrific personal quality in her voice and could never have a lesson. And I imagine that Mario Lanza was the same sort of man. He had this gorgeous, natural instrument.
Yours is my heart alone, and without you life holds no charm. Yours, every thought I own. I love the theme of every dream. All that makes life seem worthwhile.
In 1957, the following letter, over a very Italian-sounding signature, had appeared in a London daily paper. If Mario Lanza came to Britain, it said, I'd challenge him to a singing contest at the Royal Albert Hall. He would not get through half the arias. He would have to sing and not shout. Well, in January 1958, Lanza did sing at the Albert Hall, and not in response to a challenge. The place was sold out, and he was mobbed. He was almost 37. Just about approaching maturity in operatic terms. But in fact, he had less than 2 years to live. There would yet be concert tours, but there would also be many cancelled dates as well. There was another film. Again, that irony crops up, this time in the title. For the First Time. It was about, guess what? A famous American tenor in Europe. And there were not merely the eating orgies and the crash diets. There was illness too, like an almost crippling attack of phlebitis. For the last 18 months of his life, he must have been suffering from a combination of things, partly brought on by his excesses. and after he died, quite suddenly, of a heart attack in October 1959, in Rome, the contradictions went on without him. Leslie Mallory, in the Old News Chronicle, wrote, "From any operatic standpoint, Lanza never sang. He shouted musically. Everything was fortissimo, and so was his life. The music world will little note or long remember Mario Lanza's contribution to vocal splendor." Yet on the other hand, Edward Greenfield, in what was then the Manchester Guardian, said, "Operatic excerpts in his films suggest that he would have been outstanding in a generation conspicuously lacking in great operatic tenors." The serious critics either ignored Mario Lanza or they disagreed about him. But no matter, he had fans. He also had that additional magic which has kept them faithful to him long after his death. If an artist has that going for him, why should he care for critics?
I myself have one great regret. It was always my ambition from the day I saw The Great Caruso to see Mario Lanza on stage in an opera. I must admit that I shall always regret that. But when I think of another way, and I think, well, perhaps that's selfish, because Mario Lanza has thousands and thousands of fans who don't like opera. So we've got to consider those people as well, and they would never have had the chance to hear his voice.
Not just a fan, but Pauline Franklin, secretary of the English Mario Lanza Society, a group of people who, between them, possessed just about every note and every word Lanza ever uttered in public. There are bootleg Lanza LPs and tapes, just as there are bootleg Bob Dylans. There are tapes of American TV shows, pirate recordings of those Hollywood Bowl concerts from the late 40s. Somebody even played me a recording of the news bulletin announcing his death. And there are the good works.
Every October in Philadelphia, his hometown of course, they have an evening. It's called the Mario Lanza Institute Ball, and anyone is free to go to the ball, not only Mario Lanza admirers. And the money raised at this ball is used to give scholarships at the Settlement School of Music in Philadelphia in Mario Lanza's name.
The most unexpected feature about this posthumous adulation is that far from having a ladies-only attraction, more than half the members joining the society now are men, and young men at that. One of them was actually at Banbury the day I went to see Pauline Franklin at her home. He's 19, he'd been weaned off the Beatles when he was 15 by a visit to The Great Caruso on one of its periodic reruns. Lanza had, in fact, introduced Stephen Paterson to opera.
The thing that is with opera that you don't get with pop music, perhaps you do with jazz, is that you can listen to an aria or piece of classical music for a dozen times, and each time you listen to it, you can notice something different. And I think this is primarily why, after people have the first taste of opera and classical, they can listen to it again and again. And I think it is just this sort of first spoonful or taste, you know, of serious music. And this is what music needs today. It needs somebody young and exciting and alive, like Lanza in the 50s, to come along today. And also, thank goodness we've got the Albertall recordings on record, because that shows what Lanza is like in front of an audience. Because the critics say that Lanza wouldn't have been any good in front of a live audience such as in opera. Oh. I think that's a tremendous underrated record, is the Albertall recording.
Between illnesses and often unexplained non-appearances, Mario Lanza sang at quite a number of concerts during those final couple of years in Europe, but he never did make the opera stage. So anything that could be said on that point is once again mere speculation, though it's worth noting, perhaps, as a critic did, that he always seemed to apply himself more strongly to the heavier Italian songs. It would be better, I think, to confine ourselves now to an assessment from those who either knew him or knew the medium in which he worked.
I think he is very much a part of the passing parade of what we now consider to be legendary Hollywood, of vintage Hollywood. I think he was a marvellously flamboyant, outsized character who typified a certain age. I don't see that there's any sort of logical progression from the kind of era in which Lanza lived, given today's contingencies within the movies. I just don't see there's any kind of opening for this kind of character. But we are the losers, and there's no doubt about it. The movies and we, the moviegoers, are the losers.
Philip Jenkinson. And here's Joe Pasternak, the producer with whom Lanza had such success and such rows.
I'm going to try to make his life story. There's five or six big recordings that have never been used yet at Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer Studios. And, you know, the studios are not making any more pictures, but if I could get the head of Metro and get together with him, I think to use his voice and use somebody else to play him could be a great sensational piece of picture making.
Well, whether Joe Pasternak makes his film about Mario Lanza or not, the final verdict should still go to him. After all, he put Lanza into the film, which led to those 10 turbulent years.
He was a pride and joy of my life. I was very proud of being the first one who made a picture with him and gave the world a gorgeous, tremendous, beautiful, sexy voice. I always loved him. In fact, before he died, there was an assessment going on between us that we're going to do another picture. He went to Rome. He did two pictures in Rome. And then he's supposed to come back and do another one for me. And he said, "Do you still hate me?" I said, "I never hated you. I just felt sorry for you that you couldn't take success in time." And I would have done another picture with him because I believed in him. He had a certain fire in his voice and his physical attraction. He was almost everything that a motion picture star should be.
Lonely as a desert breeze, I may wander where I please, yet I keep on longing just to rest a while, where a sweetheart's tender eyes take the place of sand and skies, all the world forgot.